Many famous debates have been delivered at the Oxford Union, but what do the words we write say about us? Not the words themselves, but the text they're written in. We can all use the computer these days, and we can choose whether our letters look better in Arial or Classic Times New Roman. But who designs these fonts? Well, while we were filming in the area, I went off to investigate. Fonts, they are everywhere. We're surrounded by them. I've come to the Type Museum here in Stockwell to find out a bit more. Fonts are basically clothes that words are dressed up in. And I, for one, well, I'm quite particular about my choice of font. I am a Calibri man. I love my beloved Calibri. That is my type. Not so long ago, we all used to write letters by hand. Some people's handwriting is like scribble, others is as neat as printed text. Everybody's different and everybody's unique. But few of us write letters nowadays. We all text each other or send emails. So what does our font choice say about us? Because basically, fonts are the computer's version of our handwriting style. It's all down to taste. I think Times New Roman is a bit too classic. Arial is a bit overused, and Comic Sans polarises opinion. It looks like it was created by my four-year-old. But what do the experts think? Neville Brody is a typographer and is the brainchild behind several fonts we use on a daily basis.
Your choice of typeface says quite a lot about you. The way you dress describes your personality. The fonts you use are the same. I think most people today, they'll buy a computer, and the typefaces are just in there. No one ever drew them or designed them. They just came from somewhere out in the universe. Actually, they came on a spaceship called Microsoft. Most people will use Times or Arial. You wouldn't go out every day wearing exactly the same uniform that some big corporation had told you to wear. You'd go out and you'd choose something different from your wardrobe, but in typography, we don't tend to think like that. This is a fraction of the amount of typefaces for your computer that you can get hold of. It's extraordinary and growing exponentially every year. And it's almost a bit like the record industry in a way. You know, each week you might have another hit single.
Just look around us. We don't notice how many fonts we are subjected to every day. But imagine if those fonts were suddenly altered. We'd notice that something wasn't right. Hang on, what's different about the telephone box? But fancy font work is nothing new. Oxford University Press is the largest university press in the world, and it printed its first book way back in 1478. Martin Moore is the archivist here and a self-confessed font fan.
Type design goes back to Roman or Greek models. Early printers would look at inscriptions on Greek monuments or buildings. They'd take that as being the classical idea of beauty, and they'd try to reproduce those proportions in their own letters.
Who has the editorial decision to choose what font is used for what text? I mean, give you an example. I mean, the Bible wouldn't be printed and published in Comic Sans. I mean, that's, you know, just ridiculous. But who actually has that say?
Usually it's an editorial decision in somewhere like Oxford University Press. But as you look through printing history, you'll find that the printers themselves decided on this. Mm. And in some cases, you'll see that they would do really elaborate pieces of printing to show off what they were capable of, sure, or to show customers what they were capable of.
Especially some of the very early illuminated manuscripts. I mean, the printing there is just superb.
Absolutely. Really, and as we can see from this copy of Clarendon's History of the English Civil War, which Oxford printed at the beginning of the 18th century, here you have a title page which is a great stew of different typefaces and designs. Mm. It's really designed in those days' terms to catch the eye, to draw people to Oxford, exactly, to get their work printed from us. Type was very elaborate. It was very floral. Mm. It was very full of bling, in fact.
So being creative with your font choice is not a new idea. but constructing a font was laborious. Everything was done by hand. The design was carved out of steel, then punched into softer copper to create a mold. Tiny letter by tiny letter. These molds were often filled individually with liquid metal. It often took weeks to create an elaborate font.
It's a very, very skilled business. It's almost a dead trade today. There are very few people in the world who can still do this.
But something happened in the 1860s which would drastically limit our font choice. The typewriter arrived. This invention standardised the look of almost all professional correspondence, as the typewriter was limited to varieties of one font. We know it today as Courier, but of course its days of dominance were numbered.
The new keyboard controls a word processor, the microchip-controlled office machine of the future. That's what the extra keys are for, and that's why it could have a big future.
The rise of the computer in the 1970s and the demise of the typewriter meant that fonts had to look good on screen as well as in print. And some have even become default choices. Nowadays, Verdana is currently the most popular typeface on the internet, but it's the ubiquity of Comic Sans which confounds typographers like Neville Brody.
You see, using Comic Sans to make you look kind of slightly light and jolly and informal, for me, it's the equivalent of getting Ronald McDonald to deliver your messages to friends. It's not serious and is used far too often, but I quite like it for that.
From the comic to the uber cool, with a myriad of fonts now available to us, it's about choosing the right font for the right context and being more bold with our choices. For Neville, there's no end to the fun you can have with fonts.
So here is a number 3, but it becomes graphic form again. And I love the idea that it can become more sculptural, more modern. This is actually an S. It's quite experimental, but the typeface itself is still quite readable. We took what was designed for a boxing poster and then redesigned it to make it look a lot more feminine and poetic and graceful. So typefaces can have different kinds of lives now. I couldn't imagine this being at all possible using metal lettering.
So how does the outside world look now that I'm more aware of font? Fonts are basically the tone of voice we hear when we read. And indeed, the Guardian newspaper, look, this one here, has its own font, Guardian Egyptian, which brands the newspaper throughout, and so does the Times. But what does my favourite font say about me?
Kind of warm and cuddly and slightly classical, yearning for some kind of great old days, in a way.
Warm and cuddly, thanks a lot. Time for a new font.